The story of Prussia does not end well. Rarely since the destruction of Carthage in the 2nd century BC has an entity been so utterly and thoroughly destroyed. When Zhukov strode through the ruined streets of Berlin in 1945, someone must have felt the echoes of Carthage and Scipio. But the destruction of Prussia begins before the end of the Third Reich. The royal sovereignty of the Hohenzollerns was ripped away in 1918. Its political independence within a federal German state was lost in 1934 as part of reforms to incorporate all states under what Kaiser Wilhelm would remark while in exile, an all-swallowing state, and would be formally dismantled on February the 25th, 1947, during a conference by the Allied Control Council, the governing body overseeing the military occupation of Germany. The opening statement was, "The Prussian state, which from early days has been a bearer of militarism and reaction in Germany, has de facto ceased to exist. The territory of Prussia was divided and incorporated into the newly drawn map of Europe, and its political existence as an entity was formally abolished. However, it was not just the political dissolution of Prussia. The culture, values, religion, and even its people were largely dissolved into modern Europe. The millions of Germans who had lived in modern-day northern and western Poland and the Russian enclave in the Baltic for centuries were systematically expelled and millions died. Today, even the word Prussia has been pinned to the derogatory term for North German, Sauprussen, Prussian cow. And even Brandenburg, the progenitor of Prussia, has been separated from Berlin, its capital, and the two exist as separate federal entities. Although the architecture and monuments such as the Brandenburg Gate, the many statues of Prussian leaders, and the palaces stand as reminders of the Prussian past, as well as the existence of a unified Germany, very few people today have a knowledge of what Prussia was, and those that do are often informed by the narrative laid out by the Allies after the Second World War. The idea was that Prussia was a fluke, a mistake that should never have been allowed to exist. The state of Prussia, the entity, had prevented Germany from unifying and existing under the Enlightenment values of democracy, individual rights, and freedom, preventing it from developing like France and Britain did, and instead had moved Germany towards authoritarianism and aggressive military expansion. And I think this narrative comes partially from the appropriation of Prussian history, aesthetic, and culture by the Nazis to give legitimacy to their reign, and partially, I think, from a desire of the Allies to find a scapegoat to accept the blame for two world wars. And in my own opinion, perhaps this was the outlet not just for the Allies' anger at Germany, but fear that they bore at least some responsibility of what had happened, and the only way to keep their consciences clean was to silence any voices able to condemn them. So, if the story of Prussia ends so utterly, with the capital in ruins and the values and culture of Prussia being worn like a coat several sizes too large by Hitler and his gang of thugs, and virtually every aspect being dismantled, why then should it be of any relevance to us today? Well, I think the fundamental mistake in that line of thought is that the existence of something as finite means it has no value. Rome ended. Is it then pointless to study it? I think most historians and lovers of history would say that this is absurd, and that there's much about the ancient civilizations which bear wisdom and meaning for us today. So why should it be different with Prussia? The purpose of Prussian Renaissance is to explore and try to develop an understanding of the history of Prussia, to see if the claim that it was merely a militaristic authoritarian regime which ruined Germany has merit, or history shows them to be false accusations. In some sense, Prussia is on trial, and we as the jury need to look at the evidence of history. So, why do I begin at the end? I think primarily it's to let viewers know how the story ends, and that the focus of the videos will not be on what destroyed Prussia, not on what leads up to its end, but examining the events transpiring through its history. In a sense, it's the journey, not the destination I want to focus on. And secondly, sort of like the Studio Ghibli movie Grave of the Fireflies, to end this story with Prussia's destruction will be unnecessarily cruel, so we should start at the end. So to move on to technicalities, to the structure of this channel. The plan is that I will release two videos a week, one on Mondays and one on Fridays. The Monday video will be a straightforward walk through the history of a period in Prussian history, starting with the inheritance of Brandenburg by the House of Hohenzollern in the 15th century and the early development of Brandenburg in the 16th century, leading up to the unification with Germany in 1871. Why I don't go further than that is twofold. One, because it is no longer Prussia's history, but Germany's. And two, because I'm thinking of making a series of videos about Imperial Germany after this series. The Friday video will be a mix of videos focused on a particular person from the period, or a video focused on a cultural work, like art, music, and literature. I will list all sources in the description of the video, but the primary resource I will be using throughout this series is Cambridge University professor Christopher Clark's work, Iron Kingdom. It's an excellent book, and you will likely notice a lot of similarities between my videos and the book. I will try my best to be distinct, but essentially I think most credit should go to Iron Kingdom. There will also be other works I'll cite from and paraphrase, and I'll be sure to credit them as well. If people want, I may also consider doing a monthly podcast livestream where we can discuss Prussian history, or I could do a video answering questions people have. Neither of these two are set in stone, but let me know in the comments your thoughts, and also ask me any questions you might have. So, to conclude, I believe it's important to give a solid definition of what exactly Prussia was. What is it we're actually going to be talking about here? It's not as easy an entity to categorize as a country like France or England, where their national borders were, at least by the early modern period, fairly defined. Prussia's territory was in constant flux with a tendency towards growth, with the only real constant being Brandenburg. So I define Prussia as the political entity with its core in Brandenburg, its center in Berlin, and led by the Hohenzollern dynasty. I believe this definition outlines the history I want to cover, gives a geographic foundation, and marks the beginning of Brandenburg Prussia as a dynamic entity. Essentially, if the Holy Roman Empire built the car that was Brandenburg, the Hohenzollerns are the ones who bought it and drove it. So some final points. I think most of you already know this, but I run another channel called Fritz Imperial, where I talk about politics, culture, etc. I'll eventually set up a Patreon for the channel if anyone would like to donate. This channel will have its own Twitter, @Preussens, where I'll post images and quips about Prussian history. And most importantly, if anyone wants to, and I absolutely encourage you to, make art for this channel, please send it to me via Twitter, and if I like it, I'll post it on Twitter, and if I really like it, I'll use it in the videos. I'm sort of looking for stuff like Prussian flags, historical figures, and maybe like a sort of personification of this channel, like a little cartoon character in Prussian army uniform. Or surprise me, I'm not picky. I can't pay anything right now, but I would absolutely promote you, and it'd be much appreciated. And the same goes for any relevant sources or resources you might find. I want to have a lot of engagement from the viewership. So that's it. Thanks for watching. The first video will come out next Monday. Check me out on Twitter, and Ich bin ein Preuße, will ein Preuße sein.